For 1,600 years, an Egyptian bishop remained the head of the Ethiopian church. This indeed is a highly unusual phenomenon in the annals of the global church. In practice, however, the Egyptian archbishop, who did not know the local language, could not influence imperial policies except through providing doctrinal direction. The Etchage, abbot of Debre Libanos, who was of Ethiopian extraction, had wide-scale power in the imperial realm. Fictor Abba, 10th century, was a Syrian impostor. Originally, he was connected to the Egyptian monastery of Saint Anthony Dair Anba Antinous, from where Ethiopian metropolitans or bishops were usually selected. He was thrown out the monastery on account of corrupt behavior. After clandestinely traveling to Ethiopia, he falsely claimed to be a monk with connections to the Patriarch of Alexandria. He produced a fake letter from Alexandrian C bearing the signature of Patriarch Cosmas III, AD 921-933, that removed Abuna Petros and replaced him with a false monk by the name of Minas. Using Minas's position, Fictor succeeded to get Emperor Dil Naad deposed and replaced with his brother Emperor Anbesa Wudem. Fictor in time quarreled with Minas, whose house he razed before fleeing to Egypt with an enormous amount of property. He subsequently converted to the Muslim religion. When the truth was discovered by Patriarch Cosmas, Minas was deposed and then executed. But because Petros had died in the meantime, no replacement was made. The Egyptian patriarch refused to appoint another bishop, so the Ethiopian emperor appointed Petros's assistant as Ethiopia's bishop. The standoff between the Ethiopian monarchy and the Alexandrian See persisted until the devastation of Aksum by the queen of Banu Hamawiyah, generally recognized to be Yodith or Judith of Beit Israel, in the 9th century AD. Ethiopian Orthodox as the protectorate of South Arabian Christians. Ethiopian Orthodox rulers of Ethiopia acted as the protectors of Christianity in the early 6th century AD when the Himyarite king Dehunuas persecuted the Christians of Nagran in Yemen, and Emperor Constantine of the Roman Empire implored the Aksumite king to rescue those who remained. Emperor Caliph, who had a religious zeal, dispatched a military expedition of 100,000 soldiers under the able command of Abraha, who quickly smashed Yusuf's Dehunuas's fighting force, killed him, and put Himyar and South Arabia, which was a vassal of Aksum several times through the centuries, under the control of Caliph's chosen viceroy, Sumyafa Ashwa, also known as Esemephaios. Abraha was, for all practical purposes, an extraordinary figure in South Arabian history, ruling the realm efficiently and promoting the cause of Christianity, which had been hitherto challenged by the rapid growth of Judaism in the area and the prevalent paganism of Arabia north of Yemen. Abraha did not pass without leaving an important imprint across the Red Sea. An inscription found at Muraygan, South Arabia, records a defeat inflicted by Abraha on the pagan North Arabian tribe of Ma'ada, but soon the Christian house of worship that were under the control of the Ethiopian Orthodox Tewahedo Church were swept under the rapid expansion of Islam. Tewahedo Christianity during the Zagwe dynasty. Not long after Aksum declined in power and fell victim to the assault of the Beit Israel Queen Yodith in the 10th century AD, the Zagwe dynasty arose in central Ethiopia. The most famous among the Zagwe monarchs was Lalbela. This emperor's enduring legacy is his building of the world-famous rock-hewn churches of Roha that now bear his name. The 11 churches were hewn out of a mountain rock below ground level. The multifaceted edifices features flights of stairs, long channels, underground tunnels, and large inner compounds, all supplied with a water system. The churches of Lalbela are congregated in close proximity and are connected by subterranean passageways. One assemblage is surrounded by a trench which is 11 meters long. The Basilica of Emmanuel, Marc Aurelius, Abba Libanus, and Gabriel are all engraved from a single rock hill. The most conspicuous because of its shape, which is the sign of a cross, is the Basilica of Kedus Georgis, St. George's, which was carved from a sloping rock terrace. The Lalbela churches were all of a different design and hold on the inside antique religious implements and several forms of cross designs, as well as different patterns on the windows. The episode of Prester John. When the advent of Muslim invasions that spread rapidly, not only in the Middle East and North Africa, but also across the Mediterranean into Spain and other lands, many Christian rulers in Europe who were looking for allies to curb the expansion of Islam and who entertained the ambition of freeing the Holy Land from the Seljuk Turks received reports of a legendary emperor of Ethiopia known as Prester John, Latin Prete Anai. Prester John was, in fact, with reference to some Zagwe emperors who doubled as priests. When a letter purportedly written by Dawit, the emperor of Ethiopia, reached major Western leaders, including Frederick Barbarossa and the Byzantine emperor Comnenus, first stories circulated far and wide that contact had been established with the Prester and that with his assistance the Crusades could ultimately free the Holy Land. During the Fifth Crusade, which took place at the beginning of the 13th century, information about Ethiopia trickled to Europe through Crusaders in Egypt. Soon the Christian sovereigns of Nubia and Ethiopia, always fighting to defend their faith, became famous among European Christians. From that point on, Prester John was clearly identified with the Emperor of Ethiopia. That Ethiopian emperors threatened to cut off the waters of the Nile from Muslim Egypt was not lost on the Crusaders. The legends of Prester John inspired many European poets of the 16th century. The great Italian poet of the Renaissance, Ludovico Ariosto, for example, surmised that Prester John was an opulent sovereign who resided in a grand palace whose walls and ceilings were studded with topazes, pearls, and sapphires. Others conjectured that the Prester bore an emerald scepter, that he was attended by hundreds of princes, and that he had an archbishop as a butler and a king as a chief cook. Sects of Tewahedo Christianity. The mainstream Ethiopian Orthodox Church believes in Tewahedo Miaphysite unity and confesses the harmony of two natures, divine and human, in the person of Christ, without confusion and without separation. Following the Catholic Orthodox controversy that ensued in the 17th century, a sect called Waldakib, Children of Anointed or Unctionist, was born. The Unctionist professed that Jesus Christos became perfect man and perfect God by the anointing of the Holy Spirit in the Jordan River and not upon the incarnation. There also emerged another sect called Tsega, Children of Grace. This group supported the teaching of the three births: eternal birth of the Son from the Father, genetic birth of the Son from the Virgin Mary, and his birth from the Holy Spirit after the incarnation. The Weldekib and Tsega sects were banned by the imperial decree of Emperor Teodros II, 1855-1868, who enforced obedience by applying severe punishment. However, they are still active in some Ethiopian monasteries. Another sect, even more radical and wide apart from mainstream Ethiopian Tewahedo Orthodoxy, was a group known as Melek Ewuyan, a name coined by their opponents, implying that they were disciples of idolaters. The group professed two natures of God. The sect forbade the worship of the Virgin Mary as well as prostrating or genuflection before the cross. They taught that after giving birth to Jesus, Mary and her consort Yosef consummated their marriage. The group which happened to be a branch of the Stephanite movement that broke away, encouraged free sexual relations between men and women and engaged in such practices. In other words, they did not believe in the sanctity of matrimony. Quoting Moses' teachings about leaving one's seeds for one's brother, they taught that sexual relations with one's brother's wives or sisters-in-law were proper even if the brother were still alive. For these teachings, the sect members were condemned and punished. There was also strict anathema forbidding all Orthodox members from sharing prayers and the Eucharist services with them. They were not allowed to be buried in Tewahedo churchyards, and their children were not authorized to be baptized as Christians in an Orthodox shrine. The cult of Zakristos. Zakristos was a 16th century ecclesiast from the district of Gondar who claimed to be Christ, chose disciples for himself just like Jesus did, and appointed bishops, priests, and deacons. Initially, Zakristos and his close supporters survived with donations from those who could afford to give, but as the number of his followers increased, the donations dwindled proportionately. Famine among his followers emerged and forced Zakristos to order his religious followers to invade and pillage the areas below the tableland, where he set up his headquarters. Upon hearing the report, the ruler of the religion of the region, Beilakristos, ordered a group of soldiers to storm the mountain fortress where the false prophet's followers had retreated with their loot. When the soldiers tried to scramble up the precipice, Zakristos ordered his followers to throw huge boulders down the peak, as a result of which the army found it difficult to negotiate for the forbidding mountain. So instead of taking too many casualties, the soldiers were ordered to occupy the water source that Zakristos and his followers used. In time, thirst forced Zakristos to give himself up. After his execution, his followers scattered throughout the country, fearing that they might face the same fate. 14 years later, they gathered up again and started to preach that Zakristos had risen from the dead. Their doctrine was that Christ came first and was born to the Virgin Mary, who was of Jewish origin, but that after resurrection, he came back again to earth and was born to a Gentile virgin girl named Amata Wangel. They taught that the second birth, that of Zakristos, was decided on by the Lord to be fair to all peoples. In the first birth, they taught he was called Christos, whereas in the second he was called Zakristos. Bishops, priests, and deacons were ordained for this sect. Their celebrations and fasting days were different. They consecrated Monday as the Sabbath. Ultimately, Ethiopian Emperor Susenyos converted to Catholicism and ordered his soldiers to round up all the followers of Zakristos and put them to the sword. That brought to an end the birth of a totally new Christian religion in the world, Ethiopian Christianity and the Solomonian Dynasty. The Solomonian dynasty took power from the Zagwes in the 13th century and continued to patronize the church. As soon as this new dynasty was established, with its base south of Shoah, bordering the Islamic Sultanates, it became clear that there was danger of an almost total encirclement. Given that many ethnic groups in both the south and the east had embraced Islam, another danger was posed by the Semitic-speaking kingdom established in Harar, to the east of the Christian Empire. However, the powerful kingdom of Ifat was crushed in the early 14th century by Emperor Amda Sion. Even after this major setback, the Muslim kingdoms continued to menace the peripheries of the Christian Empire. Adal Afar then became the most formidable force in the region because it controlled key trading routes from highland Christian Ethiopia to the port of Zeila, which was situated on the coast of the Gulf of Aden. By the early 16th century, succession problems had weakened the Christian monarchy, and the military control of the Sultanate ceased. The status quo became one of raids and counter-raids, in which neither the Christian nor Muslims completely dominated the other. Portuguese influence in the hitherto isolated Empire of Ethiopia continued after this period. The Portuguese came with Catholic missionaries who succeeded to convert some of the Ethiopian monarchs, particularly Emperor Susenyos, to Catholicism. A schism soon emerged when the Catholic convert Emperor Susenyos, under the influence of a Vatican bishop, Mendes, tried to forcibly convert Orthodox Christians to Catholicism. Civil war raged until Susenyos abdicated and the Ethiopian Orthodox faith was reinstated. The Ethiopian Orthodox sects. During the last several hundred years, three sects crystallized in Ethiopian monasteries and churches. There was the main Tewahedo sect, which did not accept any new reinterpretation of Christology. This doctrine teaches the unity of two natures, divine and human, in the person of Christ, without confusion and without separation, hence the name Tewahedo, which means unity. The second group was called Kebat, signifying unction. This sect put more importance on the anointing of Christ and not on the incarnation of the Son. The third sect, called Tsega Lejoch, Sons of Grace, supported the teaching of three births: eternal birth of the Son from the Father, genetic birth of the Son from the Virgin Mary, and Jesus' birth from the Holy Spirit after the Incarnation. Though some Ethiopian emperors were swayed by the non-Orthodox sects in early periods, more recent sovereigns, Tewodros, Johannes VI, Menelik, and Haile Selassie I, discouraged the teachings of the Kebat and Tsega Lejoch sects and called on all Christians to follow only the Tewahedo line. Autocephaly. The Ethiopian Orthodox Church started to move aggressively towards autocephaly following the Italian invasion, when the Egyptian patriarch went back to Egypt, while the few Ethiopian bishops such as Abuno Petros and Mikael directly confronted the invaders, refusing to accept Italian control of Ethiopia, and were martyred as a result. Ultimately, Emperor Haile Selassie I convinced the Alexandrian archbishop that an Ethiopian archbishop should be appointed, and that from then on the Ethiopian church should be totally independent, though doctrinally paying allegiance to the Alexandrian see. Thus, the appointment of Abuna Basilios as the patriarch of Ethiopia in 1951 made the Ethiopian church totally independent. Catholicism in Ethiopia. The first Catholic missionaries came to Ethiopia with Cristóvão da Gama's Portuguese musketeers, who helped Ethiopian Christians defeat the Turkish spearheaded force of Ahmed Granje, otherwise known as Ismail El Ghazai, in 1543, mainly through the efforts of the Jesuit Peter Pius. Emperor Susenyos converted and declared Catholicism the state religion in 1622. In 1623, Pope Gregory XV appointed a Portuguese Jesuit, Afonso Mendes, as Patriarch of the Ethiopian Church. Mendes imposed Latinizations of the Ethiopian liturgy, and the convert Susenyos tried to enforce this change by use of the sword. This led to a civil war that claimed the lives of thousands of Ethiopians. In 1636, Susenyos' son and successor, Emperor Fasilidas, expelled Mendes and ordered the restoration of Tewahedo orthodoxy. Missionaries who tried to proselytize in Ethiopia was detained and deported, and in some cases executed. Catholic missionaries came again in 1839, led by the Lazaruses and Capuchins. Hostility towards Catholicism, however, made their work difficult. It was only after Emperor Menelik took the throne in 1889 that Catholic missionaries were given the freedom to preach their faith. with the support of the occupying powers, Catholic missionaries' activity expanded greatly during the Italian occupation of 1935 to 1941. Presently, the largest Catholic community is found in the capital, Addis Ababa. The Ethiopian Catholics use both the Latin and the Ethiopic rites, the latter employing the ancient Ethiopian language of Ge'ez. There were 144,000 Catholics in Ethiopia in 1967. By 2007, the National Census of Ethiopia officially recorded their number at 536,827, a significant growth, but not by a large margin compared to Protestantism. Protestant missions expanded into Ethiopia starting in the 19th century. There are three main groups: the Lutherans, the Sudan Interior Mission, and the Mennonites. The Lutherans founded the Mekane Yesus Church, which is strong in non-Amhara and non-Tigray areas of the south and west of Ethiopia. The Sudan Interior Mission entered southern Ethiopia in the 1920s. The Kale Hewat Church, which is a branch of the Sudan Interior Mission, has grown enormously since the overthrow of the Derg in 1991. The Mennonites came to evangelize after the end of the Ethiopian-Italian War in 1941. Two churches emerged out of the Mennonite mission: the Meskhete Christos, meaning Christ in the Foundation, Christ is the Foundation Church, which has roots in the West, and the Muluwengel Church, which is independent. The Muluwengel Pentecostal Church was outlawed in 1972, and its members joined Meskhete Christos, which they influenced to be charismatic with heavy evangelization. Meskhete Christos and Muluwengel churches believe in faith healing, exorcism of demons, and glossolalia. Meskhete Christos was subsequently outlawed as well, and its members were led underground by the Derg in 1982. But since the fall of the Derg in 1991, it has been growing at a rate of approximately 20% per year. Protestants in Ethiopia numbered a mere 250,000 in 1967. However, the National Census of 2007 recorded the Protestants at that time numbered 13,746,787, which is 18.6% of the total population of the country. This is clearly due to the heavy evangelization and expansion drive of the Pentecostal Church. Ecumenism. In 1965, the heads of the Oriental Orthodox Church held a common meeting in Addis Ababa, the first time for such a gathering since the Council of Ephesus in AD 431. This opened a new chapter in Eastern Orthodox Church history, and a secretariat of Oriental Orthodox churches was subsequently established in the Ethiopian capital city of Addis Ababa. The Ethiopian Orthodox Church was a founding member of the World Council of Churches when it was established in 1948. Since then, the church has been an active member. As of the start of 21st century, the patriarch of the Ethiopian Orthodox Ewahedo Church, Abuna Paulos, who holds a PhD in Divinity from Princeton University, was serving as the president of the World Council of Churches. Ethiopia's place in the division between Eastern and Western churches today. The character of the Universal Church changed after the divisive argument over Christology at Chalcedon in AD 451. It was at that juncture that the church was divided into Chalcedonian and non-Chalcedonian branches. Thus, currently, there are two different doctrines of the established church: the Eastern branch, comprising the churches of Alexandria, Armenia, Ethiopia, Syria, and Malabar in India, and the Western branch, comprising the Roman Catholic and the Greek Orthodox churches. The first group believes in Miaphysis, the unity of Christ's divinity and his human element, whereas the second one subscribes to the doctrine of two natures of divinity and humanity. Islam in Ethiopia. Just like Christianity, Islam also has deep roots in Ethiopia. It has been recorded in the Islamic tradition that the grandfather of the Prophet Muhammad saw the brunt of the Ethiopian Christian army's assault against Mecca in AD 570. A cavalry commander of the army of Abraha, the Christian viceroy of Ethiopia and Yemen, raided the neighborhood of Mecca before the final assault to destroy the Quraysh. As a result of which Muhammad's grandfather, Abdul al-Muttalib, lost 200 camels. Out of compassion, the Christian general Abraha later restored the 200 camels to Muhammad's grandfather. The first Ethiopian convert to the Muslim religion during the time when Muhammad sent his followers to Ethiopia to seek protection from the persecution of the Quraysh was a man called Bilal. After traveling to Mecca with Muhammad's followers, Bilal called the Muslim faithful to prayers, thus becoming the first Muslim. The rise of powerful religion, Muslim states. Challenges to the Solomonian dynasty and the Ethiopian Christian Empire arose parallel to the change in dynasty in the 13th century. The Ottoman conquest of the whole region of the Middle East led to the expansion of Islam in the littoral states of the Red Sea and Indian Ocean, including the coastal areas of lowland Ethiopia. This in turn helped strong sultanates to rise and challenge the highland-based Christian authority. Among the powerful kingdoms that arose were the Sultanate of Ifat in the northeastern Shoah, that of Adal with its capital in the port of Zeila, and the Islamic city-state of Harar. Ifat's challenge to the central Christian empire was successfully repelled by Emperor Amda Sion in the 13th century, but at the end of the 14th century, the power of the three sultanates coalesced under the Muslim kingdom of Adal near Harar, with its control of the port of Zeila, which was a major outlet for Ethiopia's maritime trade with the outside world. This brought about a clear threat to the Christian empire. In the early 16th century, the Christian Empire extended political supremacy over the Muslim sultanates, but because the sultanates were reluctant to pay taxes voluntarily, the only way the empire could collect its levy was by conducting periodic raids. But by 1529, there emerged the formidable Muslim force of Adal, which the Christian Empire could not subdue. Ahmed Granier's conquest. The conquest of Ethiopia's Christian empire in the 16th century by the surrogate of the Ottoman Turks, Ahmed ibn Ibrahim el Ghazi, known in Ethiopia as Ahmed Grang, meaning the left-handed, was one of the most destructive in Ethiopian history. Granier was the leader of the Ethiopian vassalage of Adal, near present-day Zeila. He was responsible for the destruction of Christian churches during his invasion of the country in the early 1500s. Though initially defeated at the Battle of Badikt in eastern Shoah in September 1528, Granier did not give up what he considered a jihad against the Christian Empire. His first major triumph over the Christian forces was at the Battle of Shimbira Kure on March 23, 1529. The empire was soon laid to waste by the armies of Granier that swept through Shoah, Amhara, and Tigray, the heartland of Ethiopian Christendom. The Ethiopian emperor made a stiff resistance, but unperturbed by new guerrilla-style attacks, Granier proceeded to occupy territory after territory and emptied the fabulous treasures of the Christian monarchs that the Europeans of the Renaissance period had described as the unmatched wealth of Prestigeon, the king of Ethiopia. When in 1539 the royal mountain fortress of Gishen was taken by Granier, all the treasures deposited there by generations of Ethiopian sovereigns fell into his hands. Because of forced conversion at the end of the campaign, 9 out of 10 Ethiopians became Muslims. Though most nominally, soon 400 Portuguese musketeers led by Cristóvão de Gama, the son of the famous explorer Vasco da Gama, arrived and Granier was defeated. Skirmishes between the two forces continued for some time. but the Ethiopian Christian kingdom was never challenged on a large scale after the defeat of the Turkish-supported Muslim Adals in 1542. The task of reconstructing the churches and monasteries that were ravaged by the forces of Grania continued for the next several hundred years. Zare Ya'iqob and Ethiopian philosophy in Hittata. Zare Ya'iqob, the son of a peasant farmer born in Aksum in AD 1592, who attended the religious school of the day and graduated after 16 years of intense university-level education. He studied grammar and poetry as well as the sacred text. After the conversion of Emperor Susenyos to Catholicism and his attempt at forced conversion of all Ethiopian Orthodox members of the church to Catholicism, there was an Inquisition. Zare Ya'iqob found himself to be a target because he had refused to renounce his Ethiopian Tewahedo faith. To save his life, he fled from Aksum and for 2 years lived a life of a hermit in a cave, where he meditated and developed some theological and philosophical ideas different from those of both the Catholic missionaries of the time and the Ethiopian Orthodox Tewahedo clerics he grew up with. His treatise titled Hittata Discourse was a critique of Judaism, Christianity, and Islam. Zare Ya'iqob argues in Hittata that intelligent human beings have the innate power to interpret the messages of the sacred text and that nothing is to be spared from critical examinations by the inherent authority of human reasoning. For the proper exercise of rational thinking, neither the sovereign nor religious authority should have the power of manipulation and authoritarianism to intimidate people from acting their conscience and exercising their power of reasoning. It is important to point out that Zare Ya'iqob's rationalistic philosophy of religion and the world of man started in Ethiopia and in Europe simultaneously, because he argued in the Hatita, the light of reason should illuminate the dark regimes of human thought.